to Jesus for the cleansing power. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood?
In the blood,
in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood?
In the blood,
in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your pure and white in the blood of...
Our God is a wonderful God. And I've been telling you that it is a privilege to be a mother. Today, by the grace of God, we are concluding this series on women. And that's why so far we have spoken on women in the beginning, how God created them in His image and as helpmate for man, and endued them with five principal responsibilities. I have spoken also on the position of women in the church, how God can use them in the area of ministry of intercession. I've spoken on the characteristics of Christian women. What are those things we need to see in your life? Last week, I spoke on the portrait of a matured woman as seen in Anna. We are in the mood celebrating Women's Day, Mother's Day, which is something very important for us to do. But God wants women to go the next step. And that is why today I'll be speaking on motherhood and child discipline. Motherhood and child discipline. My text is Proverbs chapter 29, verse 17. Correct your son, and he will give you rest. Yes, he will give the light to your soul. Correct your son, and he will give you rest. And he will give the light to your soul. It is common to believe that a bad child belongs to the mother, but the good child belongs to the father. But that should not be. God did not create any bad child. He wanted children to be godly, as I've shown to you before. The Bible holds parents responsible for the misbehavior of their children. Whether you are the husband or the wife, God holds you responsible for whatever happens to your children, because it was the unity of the husband and the wife that produced the child. In 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 13, "For I have told him that I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knoweth, because his sons made themselves vile, and he restrained them not." Do you see that? God was speaking of Eli here, condemning him for not controlling his children. Let me tell you the truth. God holds you, the father and the mother, responsible for the behavior of your children. It is you. Because, as I've said, it was the unity between you and your husband that produced that boy or that girl. God expected parents to train up their children as husband and wife. It is your combined responsibility. There are many people, they are waiting for the schools to teach their parents, their children. They are waiting for government to teach their children. No, God holds you responsible. Solomon said in Proverbs 22:6, train a child in the way he should go. He will not depart from it when he grows up. See, God accepts no excuse from parents for failure to discipline their children. God will not take any excuse from you. When your children are not brought up in the way of God, you leave them to do whatever they like, even when you know that it is diametrically opposed to the will of God, and it is against their betterment in future. You know that what they are doing can never make them good citizens of the nation, of the country, and yet you fold your hands doing nothing. God wants you to know that you owe it a duty. What is discipline? Discipline means to correct gently and bring back to the right path. To correct gently and bring back to the right path. That is discipline. Discipline is not punitive. Discipline is not when you inflict punishment. No. It is not punitive. It is corrective. That is discipline. See, in the book of Hebrews chapter 12, Hebrews chapter 12, from verse 8 to 11. But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh, which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, it yielded the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. You see that? God says, parents should apply corrective measures, not punitive measures, not to wound your child, not to destroy, no, but to mold his character, to show him how he can make a better thing out of his life, so that his life will not be ruined. See, God did not favor punishment. No, God did not say parents should be punishing their children, torturing them. No. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 17, verses 25 and 26. Proverbs 17, 25 and 26. A foolish son is a grief to his father, and bitterness to her that bear him. Also to punish the just is not good, nor to strike princes for equity. You see, God says to correct, not to punish. Every woman must know that the larger share of blame goes to the mother of a wayward child. At the end of the day, the woman will take a larger portion of the blame. That does not mean that men are exempted, no. In the book of Proverbs chapter 10 verse 1, the Proverbs of Solomon, a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish son is the heaviness of his mother. Do you see that? God wants you to know that you as a father or a mother should contribute together to give your son, your daughter, necessary upbringing to avoid sorrow in future. In the book of Proverbs chapter 15 verse 20, a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish man despiseth his mother. God wants you to understand that you need the attention of your children to correct them. Hagar was not exonerated from the misbehavior of Ishmael. You see, Ishmael inherited mockery from his mother, and the two of them were cast out. That's why you need to be very, very careful. And that's why I want to describe and define who a mother is. Who is a mother? Because not every woman is a mother. No. A mother is a woman with maternal tenderness or affection. That's a mother. A woman with maternal tenderness and affection for her child. That is a mother. You know, there are some women, they even hated their children. They were like ostrich. That's what the Bible said, who trampled on the ground her children as if they did not belong to her. You see, in the book of Proverbs, chapter 31, verses 2 and 3, what, my son, and what, the son of my womb, and what, the son of my vows? Give not thy strength unto women, nor thy ways to that which destroy kings. That's a good mother. A good mother will make her son or her daughter to be reasonable, you see, so that his or her future will not be destroyed. That's what Solomon was saying. A mother prevents anything murderous in the life of her child. Anything that can destroy your child in the future, you owe it a duty, a responsibility to God to stop it. A mother teaches her son what to avoid. In Proverbs chapter 31, when you read from verse 4 to 9, you see the mother of Lemuel, who was Solomon, telling him what to avoid: strong drink, booze, and all those things, so that his life will not be ruined. A mother guides her child in the way of God. A genuine mother will always guide her child in the way of God. Teach your children the Bible. Teach your children the way of God. Because children are the heritage of God. It was not Satan who gave you that child. It was God. And it is your duty as a parent, a father, or a mother to let your children know God, to let the word of God dwell in your children. You see, Paul was telling Timothy, he said, you have inherited faith from your grandmother and in your mother. Why? Because they planted the word of God in Timothy right away from the cradle. The same thing today. Let me tell you, the word of God will keep your son, your daughter away from Satan, and keep Satan away from your son or your daughter. When you give your children the word of God, you read it to them and you live by it. Let them see you living by the principles of the kingdom of God. Let them see you practicing what you are teaching them, and they will follow suit. Now, I want to touch different types of children. See, it should be noted that children partake in sin right away from the womb. See, in Psalm 51 verse 5, David said something that is permanent to what I've told you. In Psalm 51 and verse 5, he said, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." Your son or your daughter come into contact with sin right away from the womb. That is why when you are pregnant as a woman, you must always consecrate yourself to God. You must always pray that your womb will not be a manufacturing house for sin in the life of your son or your daughter to be born. It is very important. See, therefore, no one should make the mistake of exemption. What am I saying with that? That means you should try to start training your son or your daughter right away from the time that boy or that girl is in your womb. How do you do that? Through prayer. How do you do that? By not accepting evil thoughts in your heart. You see, the Bible mentions certain types of children. I know there are some people that say, "Oh, the mother was good, the father was good. But how do they give birth to this type of child?" Yes, there are bad children. But I want to pray that bad children will not be your portion in Jesus' name. Number one, there are stubborn children. Children that are stubborn. In the book of Deuteronomy 21, 18 to 21, you see an example of a stubborn child there. You see, stubbornness precedes disobedience. That is why you should not tolerate disobedience in your children. Disobedience to the word of God. Disobedience to government. Disobedience to the church. You must not tolerate it, because it will promote stubbornness in them. How do you undo a stubborn child? Number one, recognize that stubbornness is a spirit. In 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 23, the Bible says stubbornness is a spirit. And if you know that stubbornness is a spirit, it has to be cast out. You have to cast it out. How do you cast it out? By beating the child? No. Through prayer and by setting good example. You see, that is why I was telling you, before Mary was allowed to carry Jesus, she was full of the Holy Ghost. The same thing. If you don't want Satan to take over your children from you, you must be full of the Holy Spirit. It's very important. Check your life for the presence of any idol in you. Your child cannot just be stubborn if there is no root or seed of stubbornness in you too, or your husband. Your child must inherit stubbornness either from your husband or from you. That is why you need to go back and uproot it within yourself before you can deal with that stubbornness in the heart of your children. Number two, you have scorning or mocking children. Children who mock. Children who scorn. You have children like that. In Proverbs chapter 30 verse 17, "The eye that mocketh at his father and despised to obey his mother, the ravens of the valley shall pick it out, and the young eagles shall eat it." The spirit of mockery. You have to deal with it. There are many women, when they see their children mocking elderly people, they don't do anything to stop them. No, it's wrong. Mockery. The Bible said when you mock, your bondage will be doubled. That's why we need to be very, very careful. You get that in Isaiah chapter 28 and verse 22. Isaiah chapter 28 and verse 22. What does it say about mockery? It says, "Now, therefore, be ye not mockers, lest your bands be made strong. For I have heard from the Lord God of hosts a consumption, even determined upon the old earth." When there is mockery in you, when there is mockery in your child, that child will have his or her problems doubled. That's why you must not tolerate mockery in the life of your children. Make sure you did not transfer mockery to your children. Don't let them inherit it from you. Number three, there are children who are robbers. See, they steal. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 28, verse 24. Proverbs 28, verse 24. "Whoso robbeth his father or his mother, and saith, it is no transgression, the same is the companion of a destroyer." See, stealing or robbery is a spirit that grows up with children. Parents must uproot it immediately it is noticed. There are many women, there are many men, they indulge their children to steal. Your son goes to school, your daughter goes to school and return with another person's ruler, another person's ink, and you did not query him or her. Gradually, he or she will be graduating until he becomes an armed robber. That is why you as a woman, you as a husband, whenever you see any sign of stealing in your children, you must deal with it immediately. You can notice it through covetousness in your child. You see, when you see covetousness in your child, that is the beginning of stealing. Covetousness. He or she is not satisfied with whatever you give. He or she is always interested in what belongs to other people. You have to deal with it. Otherwise, he or she will graduate to become a robber in future. You see, look at Joshua chapter 7, verse 20 to 21. You see that man, they were fighting, and she coveted another person's gold. You see, and that was how many people died. We need to be careful. Then you have children who are strikers. They are fighters. They fight people. You see, it is not a good sign. When your children goes about fighting, it's not good. In the book of Exodus, chapter 21 and verse 15. Exodus chapter 21 and verse 15. "And he that smiteth his father or his mother shall be surely put to death." We are not saying that you should kill your children today. No, 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 no. But the moment you see the spirit of fighting, striking, slapping other people, you need to take action upon that boy or upon that girl so that he or she will not graduate to become a nuisance to the society. Parents must be very watchful of the spirit of anger and violence in their children before it developed into uncontrollable passion. In the book of Genesis chapter 4 verses 6 to 9, you see Cain. You see, if Adam and Eve they had disciplined Cain, his anger would not have developed to the point of killing his junior brother. So, you need to be very, very careful when you see your boy or your girl striking people, hitting people, demonstrating excessive anger. You need to go on your knees and you need to take steps against it. See, parents must first seek to uproot and cast out this evil spirit before attempting to overcome it in their children's life. Find out yourself. Are you volatile? Are you temperamental? As a father or a mother, deal with yourself first. Number six, you have children who curse. Children who curse. They are always cursing. There are many women, there are many men, they don't take note of it. When their children started cursing, when they are little babes, no. You address it. You get that in Leviticus chapter 20, verse 9. Cursing is an evil spirit. Whenever you discover the spirit of negativity around your child, uproot it in time before it grows. Some mothers contribute to this evil spirit in their children. You see, you get that in Genesis 35, 18. Look at the mother of Jezebel. She pronounced a curse upon her own child in 1 Chronicles 9 to 10. If not because Jabez knew the God of Israel, that curse will have affected him for life. So be very careful. Then finally, you have the children of Belial. Children of Belial, that means children who are very, very stubborn, who are uncontrollable, who are under the guidance of demons. These are street hawkers and gangsters. Always check the type of friends your children are keeping. You see, the Bible said in 1 Corinthians 15:33 that when you mix with wrong people, the good character will be spoiled. Beware of the type of people you move with, the people that surround you. Do you know what type of children God is expecting you to produce? Children of the resurrection. Children who are holy. Children who are full of the word of God. These are the children who are born of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is in them. Husbands and wife, you need to find time to put your children in the middle. Pray for them to receive the Holy Spirit. When your children receive the Holy Spirit, you will see how God will lead them. Resurrected children, they fear God and they obey His command. They are products of godly parents. That is what God said you need to understand about motherhood and discipline, parenthood and discipline. You need to, so that your children will not spoil your name. They will not destroy your lineage. They will not spoil your record. God wants you to have children who will be for the glory of God. It is my prayer, as you have listened, that God will give you total victory so that you can help your children to become godly children. Father, I want to thank you. I want to glorify you. And I pray, one of the reasons why the gospel has come is to save us because we were children of disobedience. By the coming of the gospel of the Lord Jesus, by the coming of the Holy Spirit of God, God dealt with the spirit of disobedience in us because of the obedience of Jesus Christ. Father, plant the spirit of obedience in us so that we in turn can influence our children to be obedient children in the name of Jesus. And if there are families who are being confronted by all these types of children that have listed, Father, I pray that your power will be released upon them so that they will be able to control their children and not be guilty. Thank you, Lord, for what you have done. In Jesus' name, I've prayed. Amen. May the Lord bless you wonderfully. Amen.